down to business.
Tunajengwa soko mzuri ya gorofa 3.
Infrastructure development.
Naweza nikashukuru kwa hii barabara.
Healthcare transformation. Breathtaking tourist attractions.
Kuna mti mrefu East Africa hii kuliko hii. Kwa kimombo inaitwa Kenyansis. Kimeru watu wote wanajua inaitwa mtunguru.
Set your watch, make a date with us as we explore county number 13, the county of Tharaka Nithi.
Pishi by Nation Media Group brings you Celebrity Home Chef. This is a chance to nominate your favorite celebrity to get in the kitchen and showcase their cooking skills on TV. Simply head on to @pishi254 on social media. Comment by tagging your favorite celebrity, and guess what? We might just make it happen. Tune in to NTV every Friday to catch the celebrity in action.
East Africa is transforming, and so is the East African. Cultural, social and economic integration is resulting in the transformation of the East African region. To stay true to this changing perspective, the East African is also transforming. To understand the region, get your copy of the East African. It's now more diverse, more visual, and more engaging. The East African, understanding the region.
Just last month was Mental Health Awareness Month, so we're continuing the conversation.
This person just turned me into their toy, and every evening, and it was, yeah. When I approached my mother about it, she slapped me.
What mental health needs is more sunlight, more candor, and more unashamed conversations, and that is what Unscripted is about.
You know, when people say, oh, he committed suicide. Yeah, that person who drives those big cars committed suicide. Mental health has got nothing to do with your economic status.
Tomorrow, we take a look at the state of governance. We are asking you, what kind of leadership do we need in a time of crisis? How do our leaders' decisions affect our health and general quality of life? All that and more with Joseph Warungu tomorrow from 7 a.m.
Get your back leg fired up, strong. Now reach, extend your hands way up and go back. Low push-up, hands down, step back.
Yoga is believed to help reduce the risk of non-communicable diseases, including heart disease, diabetes, and respiratory diseases.
It is one exercise that caters for your mind, body, and soul.
Positive vibes to you, light and peace. Namaste.
It is true, we have been in business for over 20 years now, empowering Kenyans to own ideal and genuine properties. And yes, the biggest and the best urban residential development in Kiambu, Amani Ridge, the place of peace, is taking shape. Let us show you what we have been up to. The Solomonic Gate is complete. The intelligent fountain of peace is up and running. The stone perimeter wall is complete, fully enhanced with razor wire for your security. The 100,000 liter capacity water tank is coming up. We also have the house designs and the title deeds for every plot. Invest in value. Call us today on 0790 300 300 or visit us at www.optiven.co.ke.
Je, maumivu ya kichwa na kukosesha amani? Kaluma Strong utuliza maumivu ya kichwa, maumivu ya mwili na hata uondoa joto jingi mwilini. Kaluma Strong ina aspirin kama kiungo. Maumivu ya kizidi, muone daktari.
This is NTV.
When President Mwai Kibaki signed the new constitution into law on Friday, the 27th of August 2010, Uhuru Park erupted into cheers of joy and celebration. Tens of thousands of Kenyans waving miniature national flags proudly sang the national anthem. Kenyans could hope again. They believed that the wide-ranging powers of the president would be tamed. They believed that the powerful provincial administration would be replaced by more accountable governments closer to them. They believed that the new Bill of Rights would defend and protect their rights. They believed gender inequality would be redressed. In short, we, the people, believed the new constitution would bring about a more peaceful, freer, just, prosperous, and fairer society. Tonight, the people review and appraise the Constitution and speak about the gains, the losses, the clawbacks, and the future of the Supreme Law. Tonight, these are our top stories.
Tonight,
I want to give it
the fight back.
How many times did you visit KEMSA?
I have not personally ever been to KEMSA.
Parliament attempts to straighten up the crooked dealings at KEMSA and Afya House. Also tonight,
matters accountability is not a matter to be negotiated in any forum.
Kaacha kutembeleana na tukakaa nyumbani. Kumbe tuliwaacha kwa maofisi wakapora pesa zote za corona.
Another day in politics, but the calls for accountability are growing louder. Plus, an impeachment plot against Governor Okoth Obado is cooking. But things are heating up in Migori.
Stop calling our MCS to Nairobi, una frustrate. You want Mbadi, bwana Mbadi. Corruption iko tu Migori, peke yake.
The arm of comfort around the besieged governor. And on team coverage tonight, the gains.
Nikapata kulipiwa school fees, full scholarship.
The losses. The clawbacks and the future of the 2010 Constitution. An appraisal by the people on our We the People series.
NTV Tonight with Smriti Vidyarthi.
Well, Kenyans appraise the constitution on team coverage tonight. And leading our coverage in Kisumu, Oko Okusa joins us. And live from Mombasa, we have NTV's Kevin Mutai. Leila Mohammed and Ngina Kirori join me right here in studio. We'll start team coverage shortly with that crew. But first, to other stories making headlines. And Health Cabinet Secretary Mutahi Kagwe is now heaping blame on alleged misappropriation of COVID-19 response funds at the feet of suspended Kenya Medical Supplies Authority Chief Executive Officer Jonah Manjari. Kagwe appeared before the National Assembly's Health Committee today, where he dismissed allegations that the CEO was acting on orders from him in contravening procurement regulations. Zainab Ismail followed the proceedings and has the details. She will be bringing us those shortly. But also, Deputy President William Ruto, he has once again reiterated calls for accountability for COVID-19 emergency response funds allegedly lost through tendering irregularities at KEMSA. Ruto now claims that for a long time, his name has been dragged into several corruption allegations, while some unnamed individuals in high places have been getting away with public resources. Kennedy Murethi is still on that story.
Deputy President William Ruto continues to call for investigations and accountability into the alleged loss of COVID-19 response funds through irregular tendering at the Kenya Medical Supplies Authority. This Wednesday, the DP, flanked by political leaders in his corner, was in Taita Taveta County.
Matters accountability is not a matter to be negotiated in any forum or to be explained away using any other means other than facing the law. Na hiyo ndio msimamo wetu.
Earlier, the deputy president had stirred up the internet with a tweet absolving himself of blame in the country's cycle of graft. He writes, "The corruption consultants, brokers and conmen, some bankrupt in 2013, are now billionaires after looting while scapegoating WSR. Their overgrown impunity is shamelessly making them steal even from the sick in a pandemic. The end is nigh. Nowhere to hide, no more scapegoating." His brigade helped hammer the point home.
Tukaambiwa to keep social distance, tuoshe mkono na tukae nyumbani. Tukakanyu, tukaosha mkono, tukaacha kutembeleana na tukakaa nyumbani. Kumbe tuliwaacha kwa maofisi, wakapora pesa zote za corona.
Sasa tunasikia ndani ya janga wamefanya majanga. Tunasikia pesa za corona hazipo tena. Je, yule aliyeitwa mwizi yuko kando? Waizi ni kina nani tena?
The leaders also drummed up support for the DP in his bid to ascend to power in 2022 in the face of unrelenting opposition.
2022, hayo mafuta ya upako, sio mimi nimesema, ni nyinyi. Yako kwa nani? Yako kwa nani?
Mungu anasema atakuandalia meza mbele ya maadui wako. Ule unywe wakitizama.
Tutatoa kura hata kama iko ndani ya mdomo wa simba, kwa uwezo wa Mwenyezi Mungu tutaitoa tukupatie ushinde na utangazwe.
Dipiruto has been galvanizing support in the coast counties, with sources in his camp now saying he will be rolling out countrywide tours. Kennedy Murethi, NTV.
Now, a day after the Orange Democratic Party and Migori members of County Assembly resolved to impeach Governor Okoth Obado over graft allegations involving his own family, a section of residents of the county have expressed dissatisfaction with the move. They accuse ODM of doublespeak on corruption in the counties, as Eunice Omolo now tells us.
37 out of 41 MCAs on Tuesday resolved to remove Governor Okoth Obado, facing a 74 million shillings graft scandal, acting on a directive from the ODM party's National Executive Council. The decision to impeach has angered some Migori residents.
MCAs wako na Governor Okoth Obado sababu wanajua kazi governor anafanya hapa Migori. Nyinyi mlioshwa sababu ya pressure, na mkitaka kujua muendelee.
ODM hawezi pata hata kura 10 kwa hiyo impeachment. Obado will win by the end of the day.
A section of the residents now accuse the ODM party of double speak in pushing for accountability for graft in the counties.
Bwana Mbadi, corruption iko tu Migori peke yake. Stop calling our MCS to Nairobi, unawa frustrate. You want Mbadi.
Nao sheria ifuate mkondo wake. Kama ni kumuhukumu Obado, waanze kuhukumu kutoka kwa wale wafike kwake. Hatuna shida. Itakuwa ni sheria imefuata mkondo wake.
Party chairman John Mbadi says the decision to impeach Obado was necessitated by the anti-corruption court verdict that barred the governor from accessing his office.
It may be a painful one, but it is the decision that can be made. That is to have the governor of Migori County impeached.
but there are a number of issues that are wrong with that decision. Sospito Jamong, the governor for Busia, nothing has been done. There is no meeting that has been convened to remove him. We have even Sonko. In as much as Sonko was elected on Jubilee Party, the motion of impeachment must not be moved by the Jubilee MCAs. The party can even summon the ODM MCAs in Nairobi and ask them to move an impeachment motion against Sonko. Nothing has been done of the sort.
Obado was arrested last week alongside 9 other individuals, 4 of them being his children, accused of misappropriating close to 73 million Kenya shillings of public funds. The sitting to debate the oust of the governor at the county assembly was to take place today but did not because some MCAs were away. Eunice Omolo, NTV.
All right, let's now turn our attention to team coverage tonight on the Constitution a decade on. First out is our senior reporter, Leila Mohammed, who's looking at the gains for the citizen. Leila.
Smriti, while the clamor for constitutional reforms is still the subject of debate, many say the last decade has brought about significant change. They single out Chapter 11 on devolution for transformation at the grassroots. Take a listen.
Schools are out of session for the moment, but Mary Ayo, an early childhood education teacher in Bungoma County, cannot wait to re-engage with her little learners in class. Ayo's journey to imparting knowledge to the young Kenyan's class was not easy, but she says the opportunities accorded to her in the last few years have been a great boost to her career.
Nikapata scholarship. Nikapata kulipiwa school fees, full scholarship. Niko na certificate yangu ndio hapo. Hivi kwa sasa mimi niko masilimu. Wakati nilipata nikiwa kibabi.
Ayo notes that before devolution, early childhood learning was under the Ministry of Education, whose schools were fewer and far apart, especially in the rural areas, where physical and sometimes financial access hindered some from being able to learn.
These children, they learn by touching. Akiwa darasani, hivi vitu vyangu, mimi kama walimu, sina wasiwasi ati vitapotea. Unaona? Katika darasani, lakini pale nyuma tulikuwa tunafundisha chini ya mti.
Tulikuwa tunatumia udongo, tunatoka na udongo nyumbani, tukienda shule, kama hiyo ndio tulikuwa tunaitumia kama material. Angalau maisha ya wanafunzi wa chekechea yamebadilika. Kwa nini? Tunaona ya kwamba madarasa yamejengwa, kuna material ya kutosha, hata udongo bado unatumika, but wanafunzi wanakaa mahali pazuri.
Devolution has made a difference in the lives of those who now have jobs.
Na ukiangalia hayo malipo ya wazazi, haikuwa nzuri ambayo inaweza ridhisha mtu katika maisha ya sasa. But kulingana na ugatuzi ilipokuja kwa county governments, naona ya kwamba sisi kama walimu wa chekechea, tumefaidika.
For many youth, the prospects of gainful employment are what keeps them going. For youth like David Nabakwe, the opportunity to serve his community and also earn his daily bread under the Youth Initiative Program run by the Kakamega County Government is one of the benefits of the new constitution.
Ambapo wakati youth service itaisha, tutakuwa tunashukuru bana governor, ambapo tutakuwa tunaweza kwenda nyumbani kama tuko na skills. Wenzetu wanasoma carpentry, wengine tunasoma electrical, kama mimi mwenyewe nasoma electrical, kuna wenye wanasoma catering.
Devolution has changed the lives of women who run small-scale businesses in rural counties like Makueni.
Wakati wa samani, tulikuwa tunaenda Embu, tunatumia pesa mingi, watu walikuwa wanachoka. Kama wewe unafuatilia zile title deeds, unaenda mbali, saa hii watu wamebaidika sana, maana ni huko Makueni ndio tumepata hiyo.
Women in places like Makueni are able to deliver safely at facilities within reach.
Wamama walikuwa wanaenda mahospitali, walikuwa wanasaa, wanalipa. Saa hii wamama wamesaidika sana, maana kuna ile inaitwa Linda Mama, wamama wanazaa vizuri bila kulipa chochote.
In the Northern Frontier region, many residents say much is still pending, but acknowledge that gains over the last few years are a great start. They say infrastructure development has enabled the road network to bring in business opportunities for the locals.
Atukua na lami, atukua na hizi ma college, mambo ya kazi ilikuwa very low sana. Tangu devolution ilikuja tumeona maendeleo nyingi sana.
Sisi tukiwa wa Kenya, sasa tukiwa hapa kaskazini mashariki,
angalau tumedhulumiwa mara ya kwanza. And Kenya nyingine kienda mbele, wakijengewa barabara, highway zao zimeshikana kama Thika highway, sisi tunajivunia only this and 10 years of devolution ndio tunajivunia kwa Wakenya.
In Nairobi, where majority of government services were offered before 2010, life was and is still a challenge for the youth, especially when trying to engage in business.
Na ningetaka kuongea mambo ya Nairobi kwa jumla, hasa haijakuwa implemented to the latter, because I would say it is only 20% that has been implemented.
Kuna mangavana ambapo wamefanya kazi na wengine ambapo wanaendelea na kukula ile hera wamepatiwa wasaidia wajiko. Kwa hivyo ile kitu naweza sema ni kitu moja. Hii katiba itakapofika wakati inafanywa amendment pahali popote pale, ikuwe ni katiba ambapo italete manufaa ama pesa zile ambapo maendeleo yale yamepatikana kidogo kwa mwananchi iweze kuongezeka.
But even as the garden that is devolution continues to thrive, it is never all peace and pancakes, as Kevin Mutai has been exploring. Kevin?
Although the Constitution of Kenya came with significant changes, and many Kenyans are still feeling that it has failed them. Land injustices, gender balance, and marginalization are among the key areas of concern for many. We found 81-year-old Munir Mazrui at home in Old Town, Mombasa. Mazrui tells us that he was once arrested for demonstrating against a senior government official during the Moi regime. The official wanted to grab the now Mamangina Recreational Park. This led him and others to seek shelter under the Constitution to fight for what they deem right for the community. Munir claims a property he had purchased in Nyali in 1986 was grabbed by a member of the judiciary in Mombasa, who allegedly worked in collusion with officials at the Ministry of Lands.
Vile ndakuna kotini na naomba koti nipe haki, utaki kunipa haki, wali ntupa.
Land related injustices have affected a lot of Kenyans, escalating to oppression and marginalization of millions of people in the country who have been denied their rights to own land, just like Mzee Mazrui, thanks to the cartels and unscrupulous individuals who have been working day and night to rob them of their property.
Wakika sikujua nifanye nini. Manake kupata haki singeweza kupata haki. Na mpaka sasa sijaweza kupata haki. Watu wanapigwa, wengine wanauawa. Msimamo kama haya ndio ambayo yamefanya kuwa hii nchi iko katika hali mbaya sana.
This single mother says she too lost her land in Mikindani in 2007 through unscrupulous means.
Nilifanya kazi ya kushona nikisomesha watoto wangu. Na nikafanya kidogo nikanunua hiyo plot isaidie watoto wangu. Na nikapewa allotment letter na nililipia. Lakini sasa huyu jirani wangu akaja akainyakua juu kwa juu akachukua title. Na tangu wakati huo tunasumbuana na bado huwa namuona. Na nimetembea hata nimeshinda na kupata usaidizi.
This, among many other issues, lead citizens to the ballot every election season to choose leaders to represent them with hopes of finding solutions. But according to Munir, those in positions of power have neglected their responsibilities and instead taken care of their own interests.
Tukipata president mwanamke, pengine katika tamu moja au tamu mbili ataweza kuchange nchi ifanyike sasa. Waweza kuwa uzuri sana.
It is evident that many Kenyans yearned for a constitution anchored on essential values of human rights, democracy, social justice among many. But right now, it is also clear that some are still advocating for proper implementation so as to discover these values.
Tatizo liko kwa serikali. Maniki serikali inafuata mpango ile wataka wao. Hawafuati sharia ya constitution. Hawafuati sharia ya constitution. Na constitution ndio ambayo ndio law kubwa katika nchi. Wataka kulitatisha katiba kwa faidi wao. Hii katiba tulionayo ni miaka 10 tu sasa. Hatujaweza kuimplement kisawasawa. Ngoja tutaka badilisha nyingine. Sio haitawezekana.
For people like Munir, the hope is that Kenyans will agitate for a change in the constitution to bridge the gaps in corruption so that over the next 10 years, those who've suffered losses can bite the fruit of the 2010 constitution. While some of this may feel may be resolved through full implementation of the constitution, some may not. Back to Smriti in studio.
That's right, Kevin. Thanks very much. NTV's Oko Okusa will have more on that particular topic when we return from this short commercial break. Stay with us. Team coverage is back in a moment.
For a better tomorrow, don't forget to do the 1-2-3 with Colgate every night.
Sona moja imetengenezwa kwa njia speciali ili kupambana na maumivu kwa haraka. Sona moja ina aspirin kama kiungo. Sona moja, kitulizo kamili. Maumivu ya kizidi, pata ushauri wa daktari.
So vile nasema, wache ni kubatie statistics. Niko na gamia 1,500. Tunakuwa drapo gamia na kuwa 6,000. 2,000 na tengeneza leather, na tengeneza viatu, wallet, kibeti, na uza hapa, na batia wewe 50%. Wache niweke credit ni kupigie.
Namna gani wewe? Hii mambo ya kuishiwa na credit kila saa. Come on, nunua hiyo simu ya Vodafone. Calling fiber to fiber is 0 shillings per minute. And it is not expensive. Only 2,999 Kenya shillings.
Alo hali wali wa. Hata fadhali hiyo credit ikae, ninunue simu basi.
Faibika leo na Vodafone for only 2,999 Kenya shillings. It will always be free to call fiber to fiber.
Sio watu wengi wanajua maneno ya chuma. Nasima kutafute ule fudi au wana deal na chuma ya doshi. Nikishika, nasikia uzito, unasikia muogeza mshahara.
Jijenge na doshi steel, chuma ya nguvu.
Welcome back. Team coverage continues right now and we take you live to the county of Kisumu where NTV's Oko Okusa is. Okusa, what did you find out when you spoke to the people?
Well, Smriti, at the center of this passage, I mean, it's culture. At the center of this fight back is culture, which many say has hindered the passage and full implementation of some sections of the Constitution, especially the two-thirds gender bill, which has failed 4 times. And I spoke with some elders, and this is what they had to say.
Even though the 2010 Constitution recognizes culture in Chapter 2, Article 11, as the foundation of the nation, there are certain sections of the document that seem to put the new laws and culture at loggerheads. Take, for instance, Chapter 5, Part 1 that addresses land. In Article 60, under Principles of Land Policy, it eliminates gender discrimination in law, customs, and practices related to land and property.
Clauses in the Constitution, which gives my daughter or my sister land in a rural home, that should be changed immediately because it pollutes the culture.
We would like the land to be written, the title deed, to be written on the name of the father and the sons. Because that fear of a girl married to another place, disagrees there with the husband, comes here, you give her the land, then you register her here, she gets the title deed. One day she might sell this land here when she's going to another husband.
A clause should be put such that when my daughter inherits my land, she's not allowed to sell it. This land is supposed to be passed to the next generation.
Even where they are married, they were not allowed to own land. Yeah, so that is one of the setbacks in the culture that has been addressed by the Constitution. Because now the Constitution, the right to property, is guaranteed to everybody, irrespective of gender.
Implementation is what we are crying for. Mm. Because implementation of the law has been something that is kept in shelves.
Okay.
They don't want to implement it so that they can allow women to access land.
Another area where culture and the 2010 Constitution part ways is Chapter 4, Part 2, that touches on rights and fundamental freedoms, where it states in Article 27, Clause 3, that women and men have the right to equal treatment, including the right to equal opportunities in political, economic, cultural, and social spheres.
When a woman wants to divorce a husband, the fathers, the original fathers and mothers sit together. Then they ask the daughter, why do you want to leave that person? If they don't find a good reason, that lady or that girl will be told to go back and make her own house there.
The culture has stereotyped the women that they are classified in the group of children. Mm-hmm. That there are people who should always decide for them.
Mm-hmm. Well, a decade has elapsed and another has begun. What does the future look like, Ngina Kirori?
So the big question is it time to amend the Constitution and address its shortcomings? If so, when and how should these changes be brought about? Well, we spoke to a few Kenyans on what they would like addressed, if at all.
The future for the marginalized, oppressed, and those that felt forgotten by the government seemed to be brighter on the 27th of August 2010, when the Constitution was promulgated. But 10 years later, the progress of the Constitution can only be measured by the very people it was made for. So do the people want changes now?
Ningependa tu katiba ibadilishwe juu hiyo katiba ya miaka 10 ya kwanza imepita, hatujakuwa na hata mabadiliko mazuri.
Ingawa hiyo katiba inaenda kubadilishwa, wasiandike tu mambo ya vijana kwa katiba na wanakosa kutekeleza, afadhali waache kuziandika.
And for others that have endured the changing times in the country, such as 53-year-old Isaiah Omolo and his barbershop, the change that the Constitution promised in improving standards of living has been underwhelming.
Wakati wa serikali ya Moi ilikuwa mzuri kuliko hizi zingine. Sababu hata mimi wakati huo nilikuwa nauza, nilikuwa naona pesa ilikuwa inapatikana. Hata hizo masitarehe mtu anaweza aende, lakini siku hizi mambo yamekuwa magumu, hata kitu ya kukula peke yake ni shida.
Isaiah's is not an isolated case. Just a stone throw away sits Mama Kim, who sells githeri in the neighborhood. She says the Constitution's promise to elevate women's rights is still a distant dream, and no reforms to the Constitution will make a difference to them.
Enyewe hii katiba, wananchi ambao wako kwa maisha ya chini, wameendelea tu kufinyililika. Kwa sababu kama hapa mtaani, maisha imekuwa tu ni kustruggle. Hatujapata watu ambao wanaweza simama na wamama vizuri ama wale wanaweza simama na vijana wetu.
But there are those who still have hope and trust in the 2010 Constitution. Take Larry, aka Lori Ndogo, for instance, a former inmate who received his freedom through Section 51 of the Constitution that allowed his prison time to be revised, which now allows him to earn a living as a sugarcane trader.
Hiyo yenye ilijengwa katiba mpya imesaidia. Sendia watu wajela kuzikitambu kulikuwa na kunyongana. Siku hizi ya kuna kunyongana. Kulikuwa saa zingine umefungua maisha. Like, hautaona watu wako tena. But katiba ikabonga, kuna venye bado we ni mwana Kenya.
Mina seme imesaidia inji pakubwa. Because katiba
imefanya tumekuwa na kitu kama devolution. Kwa sababu devolution ndio maendeleo vile zinaendelea. Hata saa hizi unaweza zungumza. Because of the new constitution, we are free to speak.
While both sides of the coin have their own arguments for and against reforms to the constitution, the people's desire remains the same: a just, free, peaceful, and prosperous society.
Well, this is just a sample of what the population thinks. And that's it for team coverage tonight. Back to you, Smriti. Right, Ngina and the team, thanks very much. Remember, team coverage is back next Wednesday. For now, let's take you back to our top story. And Health Cabinet Secretary Mutahi Kagwe is now heaping blame on alleged misappropriation of COVID-19 response funds at the feet of suspended Kenya Medical Supplies Authority Chief Executive Officer Jonah Manjari. Kagwe appeared before the National Assembly's Health Committee today, where he dismissed allegations that the CEO was acting on orders from him in contravening procurement regulations. Zainab Ismail followed those proceedings and now brings us the details.
Hold on, because you have had a chance.
In the latest twist to the COVID-19 millionaires saga, Health Cabinet Secretary Mutahi Kagwe has rubbished claims by suspended KEMSA CEO Jonah Manjari last week that he received instructions from him and PS Susan Muchache on procurement of COVID-19 protective kits.
Was there any individuals who were forcing you to make some of these decisions outside the board sanctions?
As I said earlier, there was some.
Which PS, and be specific, which PS?
Susan Muchache.
Yes, yes.
There were requests from the cabinet secretary, honorable.
Written or by phone call?
Either phone calls, most of them SMSs and phone calls.
Yes.
We did have from the national emergency
who response.
Which CS? It's good you give us names
which
for the
CS?
Record.
We've said honorable Mutahi Kagwe.
Yes.
My job is has never been, and will never be, to ask anybody to break the law in the saga, in the organization that we are in, and I haven't. But it is up to an individual. And when you go wrong, then you don't go wrong because the CS told you to go wrong. You go wrong because you're a poor manager and you don't know how to manage and you don't know how to use the law in terms of procurement procedures.
CS Kagwe and PS Muchache dismissed assertions that they had urged Manjari to award tenders to particular individuals and companies.
At no time did the ministry submit a list of suppliers from which KEMSA would buy. What the ministry did was to simply adopt the rationalized budget, because remember at that time we were in the middle of a crisis, but on the other hand, we had to ensure that we spent what we had available.
I have no interest in any company at all that is working or trading with PPEs. There are over 60 companies. The companies that deal with the supply all sorts of materials at KEMSA, to my understanding, are more than 60 companies. And I have no interest in any of them that has either supplied or going to supply.
The ministry acknowledges that KEMSA went beyond the stipulated budget, at times even bypassing the ministry and dealing directly with the National Treasury.
Looking at what had been procured and what the ministry had asked for, actually, the institution had gone way beyond the request. So at that point, it was just a question of capping them at 758 million so that we could be able to process that.
The money that was spent on buying PPEs, on buying equipment, on buying commodities, on buying ventilators, all those things are in the warehouses of KEMSA. There is nothing, there is no loss in as far as the purchase of quantities and commodities is concerned. The only loss that is envisaged is the one that I'm talking about, which is essentially an operational loss, as is going to be made by all other institutions in Kenya for the time being. So I want to clarify that issue very, very clearly and to say what we are dealing with is operational losses because of the price drop.
CS Kagwe is now advising the Medical Supplies Authority to find a way to dispose of the excess COVID-19 equipment bought at a higher price at the current market rate to reduce the huge loss.
It is to the ministry, and particularly you, to convince us and Kenyans that you never interfered. And I will ask you, how many times did you visit KEMSA?
I am actually feeling bad to say this because it is something that I should not say, but I have just been so caught up with the management of COVID-19 that I have not personally ever been to KEMSA.
The health committee is tomorrow expected to sit with the directors of the companies said to be involved in the alleged scandal, among them Megascope Healthcare Limited, which is said to have been awarded a tender amounting to more than 190 million shillings. Zainab Ismail, NTV. Some staggering revelations there, and we will be following those proceedings tomorrow, so do be sure to stay with us. Well, let's now bring you the latest COVID numbers, and it has been 173 days since the first COVID-19 case was reported in the country, and tonight the decline of infection numbers continues. 178 more people have tested positive in the last 24 hours from a sample size of 3,474. The country's cumulative caseload now stands at 34,493. Kenya has conducted 459,562 tests to this day. 238 patients have recovered, bringing the total number of recoveries to 20,449. Meanwhile, four more people have succumbed, bringing the total number of fatalities to 581. Let's look at the spread of the infections. Nairobi County registered the day's high of 48 new infections, followed by Kericho County there with 24 new infections. At this point, we take a breather on NTV Tonight. Stay with us. The business news is coming up next with Julian.
You have worked so hard. Now your project is nearing completion. You now need to crown your labor. For over 50 years, East African Cables has been a premier manufacturer of high-quality electrical cables, manufactured to international standards for the region, giving you the reliability and safety you deserve. We manufacture an extensive range of power cables for applications in domestic and industrial wiring. Our work speaks for itself. Get in touch. Let's talk cables. Kumbuka, Wire C Wire. East African Cables. Connecting lives.